Joystick Drift has become the bane of gamers across every single platform. Whether you have the original Nintendo Switch Joycon or the latest Thumbmaster Elite 5000 for the PlayStation 5, the end result appears to be the same. These sticks will eventually wear out and start to drift. Now, we've taken a detailed look into this issue for both the Nintendo Switch and PlayStation 5 controllers, and we found that drift was mainly caused by the gradual wear on the resistive elements inside the thumbstick housing. It's expected that components will eventually fail, but the reason these things have been causing such a fuss is the extremely limited lifespan of the thumbsticks. A mere 2 million cycles that could potentially see a controller failing in as little as 4 months based on only 2 hours of gameplay a day.
Damn.
Needless to say, this is a problem, and it's been a problem for far too long now. But there may be some good news. We're seeing some interesting hardware being released, which prompted us to take another look at the state of gaming controllers. First things first, what does Joy-Con drift look like? No, I don't mean what it looks like in Zelda, we've covered that. What does it look like at the board level? Let's take a look at the cause of drift in current generation console controllers so we can better understand the possible solutions. These thumbsticks are made up of several consumable components, the biggest culprit for drift issues being the potentiometers, or POTS for short. Each thumbstick has two POTS inside a plastic casing, one for the X-axis, that's left and right, and one for the Y-axis, up and down. A potentiometer is just a variable resistor, and these ones are rated at 10 kilo-ohms. The voltage entering the potentiometer is 1.8 volts through this pin. The wiper sets the resistance on the potentiometer, which in turn defines the voltage. This analog signal is then processed into a digital signal by another chip, and sent to your console for further processing. Let's see what happens when we check the voltage that's being output while the stick is centered. This is interpreted as the center point, so your character shouldn't be moving on screen. Now watch what happens when I move the stick and recenter. The value for the center point has changed. And again. And again. If this is the center, these variations are interpreted as movement. This is what drift looks like at the component level. These variations can be corrected by software if it remains constant and predictable. Drift is introduced when that variation becomes too great or too unpredictable for the software to correct. So what's the alternative? Well, flight sim and drone enthusiasts will tell you that it's Hall effect sensors. What's the Hall effect? Basically, it's a phenomenon that allows us to manipulate voltage using magnetic fields and was first discovered in 1879 by American physicist and pro gamer Edwin Hall. What's special about Hall effect sensors is that they eliminate the physical contact between the wiper and the resistor. Unlike potentiometers, there's no scraping, only the power of miracles. That magnetism. Gullikit released the King Kong 2 Pro in 2021, marking the first time Hall sensors have been used in a gaming controller since 2006. Let's open up the controller and have a closer look. The innards are notably simpler than a PS5 controller. Everything is pretty accessible. The battery uses a 2-pin connector, which is fantastic. And getting to the thumbsticks themselves is pretty easy. The first thing you'll notice about the thumbstick is the form factor. On the outside, it looks exactly like an Alpine pot sensor. We think this form factor was maintained so it can very easily be integrated into existing circuits and designs. Let's take a look at the thumbstick housing and see what's behind these blue covers. Where there are hole sensors, there are magnets. The way the magnet is aligned horizontally is important. As the stick is moved, you'll either have the negative pole of the magnet closer to the sensor or the positive pole of the magnet closer to the sensor. And that's it. We need to desolder one of these sticks to get a better idea of what's happening. Once the component is off, we can immediately see the two tiny hole sensors, one for each axis. Note that each sensor has three pins, just like a potentiometer. Here we have voltage in, ground, and voltage out. Let's plug this board in, and with the help of gamepadtester.com, we can take a look at how those sensors work. This top sensor controls the left-right movement, which is the x-axis. Watch what happens as I simulate the movement of the thumbstick with just the magnet. Without touching any component on the board, we're pushing the imaginary thumbstick to the left and right. The sensors in these controllers are linear ratiometric hole sensors. Now that sounds complicated, but really all it means is that the sensors output a predictable and repeatable voltage. We can see this in action. There's 3.3 volts going in on this pin, and dead center outputs 1.78 volts on the output pin. Now watch what happens to the output voltage as we simulate thumbstick up and thumbstick down. The linear portion is the gradual increase and decrease in voltage. The output voltage is an analog signal, which has to be converted to a digital signal. It's then forwarded to your console, and at that point your console passes this on to the game, which interprets it as movement. The question remains, what does this mean for the average gamer? Regardless of which platform you're on, we can say without a shadow of a doubt that there is a solution to the drift problem. Now, whether manufacturers pick up the solution or not is entirely up to them.